based on a 20,000 ton production facility, 35 year mine life, close to 1,000 milligrams per liter grade with a very high NPV of 1.2 billion US and, you know, almost 50% IRR and, you know, payback of less than 2 years. So we're looking at a very, very, very good project with low cost of less than $3,000 a ton.
Hello and welcome to Assay TV. Today we're talking with Neo Lithium and I have Carlos Vicens, who is the Chief Financial Officer. He's joining us today from Toronto. Carlos, great to see you. Wanted to talk about your project there down there in Argentina, the 3Q project. One of the world's largest and highest grade projects in development. So tell us a little bit about what you've got down there.
Sure. Thanks, Leo. I appreciate it. Thanks for having us on Assay TV. Our asset's called Tres Quebradas, which is 3Q. We call it that for short, obviously with a complicated name. But yes, like you said, it's a very large resource. We have over 7 million tons of resource. And out of that, we have about 1.3 million tons of reserves. So we have a reserve base. And in that reserve base is what we build our pre-feasibility study. But there's another couple of very important qualities that our project has. And one is, like you also mentioned, is very high grade. In fact, is one of the largest in the world. At this point, it's about the second or third largest, depending on what type of reserve you use. And also, and more importantly, is it has the lowest amount of critical impurities of any known salar in the world. And that is sulfate and magnesium. And that is extremely important when you look at the operational cost. So our asset, like you said, it's in Argentina, it's in development. So we're working on our complete feasibility right now. Our pre-feasibility that was put forth last year in 2019 showed unbelievable results based on a 20,000 ton production facility, 35 year mine life, close to 1,000 milligrams per liter grade with a very high NPV of 1.2 billion US and, you know, almost 50% IRR and, you know, payback of less than 2 years. So we're looking at a very, very, very good project with low cost of less than $3,000 a ton, very low cost as well on the capital intensity because of the fact that it's so high grade that we need a lot smaller ponds. So that the ponds are a significant amount of capex in the brine project. Right, so between the low cost of operating and the low cost of capex, that's where you get those higher returns. And a couple of weeks ago now, which is one of the most important news that we've had this year, is that we brought in CATL. And CATL is the largest battery manufacturer for electric vehicles in the world, obviously in China. They're a Chinese company. They came in at the corporate level with a small investment of around $8.5 million for around 8% of the company. One of the issues that we had as we went through our complete financing strategy was that, you know, because of the COVID situation, a lot of the due diligence and things like that would not be able to get done. So CATL was the one that promoted this type of investment so we could get to work together now on the feasibility front, which is an important part of the final cost and the capex that will lead to that final financing.
And, you know, it's obviously very important for, you know, lithium producers to be working very closely with companies downstream to make sure that you're going to be producing the right materials.
That's correct. I mean, and that's one of the things we always wanted to do. We said to the market that we wanted to partner up with a company that will bring value. Obviously, look, I mean, we're not going to kid ourselves. We also need financing to build the project, but the ideal situation is to bring a partner that has not only the mining, the financial capacity. With CATL is a market cap of, you know, 60 billion US and has about 4 billion in cash right now in their bank. But they also bring the downstream side. So they understand quite well what they need and how they need the lithium to produce in their batteries. So that is one of the values that CATL has, along with obviously the knowledge of what the market needs right now to make batteries. You know, CATL has had tremendous success over the last 4 years. Has gone from less than 4 gigawatt hours of production to over 40 gigawatt hours of production. They expect to grow that, 2-3 fold over the next two or three years. So this is one of the companies that you want to partner with, that's knowledgeable about the market, that it's growing, and also that understands the mining side a little bit, but more so on the downstream and the chemical side.
So as you're building your processing plant, you can tweak it to make sure that the product you're producing is absolutely spot on. You've already built a pilot plant. What sort of grade and purity are you achieving?
Well, the pilot plant is we built it last year, and we produce as you build the pilot plant. As you know, the pilot plant, what you do is that you kind of build it and you tweak it as you produce batches in order to get from technical grade all the way to battery grade, and we were able to do so already. So we're producing what we call battery grade. But battery grade is a funny definition, because what's battery grade for you may not be battery grade for CATL. And of course, there are different types of, I would say, impurities that may cause problems for certain customers. And that's exactly what we have with CATL. CATL already has our battery grade lithium carbonate. They're looking at it, they're working through it, and we're in discussions with them. We had a call yesterday with them. We're in discussions. We will have a call later on tonight. We just signed an agreement 2 weeks ago, and the agreement hasn't even closed, and we already had several discussions. So it's an ongoing discussion, which is going very well, and it has gone well even before we got to an agreement on the investment. So, there are many different aspects on in terms of the impurities side of the final lithium carbonate or product that CATL will like. And that's something that will get worked on over the next few months into the feasibility project.
And in terms of finishing the development of the project, tell us a little bit about the sort of jurisdiction you're in. You're up there in what they call the Lithium Triangle, up near the Argentina-Chile border. Yeah?
That's correct. We are. The Lithium Triangle is a very well-known triangle, that it's high up. It's in the Puna, and it's around, all the brines that are in that area, around anywhere between 3,500 meters above sea level to around 4,400 meters above sea level. So they're very high up, and that's what makes them unique, because the sun radiates a lot and the evaporation is very high. So when you put the brine in the ponds evaporate anywhere between 2 to 3.5 meters per year. And that is exactly what you want. You want free evaporation from the sun on these evaporation ponds that will lead to that concentrated brine that will then go into the final product and the processing. But, about 50% or 90% of all brine resources are in this area. We own 100% of the salar that we're in, and that is something unique as well that I didn't mention before. Mm-hmm. The majority of these salars are pretty big. Our salar is also big. It's about 20, 25 kilometers long, about 5 kilometers wide, and we own 100% of the salar. Where other salars are partnered up or have different owners, that can cause problems, because when you have a liquid resource and you're taking liquid out of the salar, then whatever you're taking out can change what others are taking down 2 kilometers down the road. So that's good to have as well. So the region is, we're in Catamarca, one of the most mining friendly jurisdictions in Argentina. They have one of the largest copper mines in the world here in Catamarca. They have another production, lithium production. Livent produces, I don't know if you know Livent, but Livent's one of the top four, top five producers of lithium worldwide, and they're in the same province that we are. So that the province is well-versed not only in mining in general, but also in lithium mining.
And there's a lot of expertise, I guess, locally that you can tap into to help build a team to develop the project.
Yes, yes and no, and let me explain that. So the expertise that we have, we've brought it through our past experiences in other salars in Argentina. So our team is local. Our team in Canada is very small, myself and two others. So we don't need people at the corporate side. What we need is everybody down in Argentina. So our CEO lives in Argentina. Our COO is also Argentinian. Our entire team is Argentinian, with a couple of Chileans, that obviously Chileans are the most experienced in the lithium side on the other side of the border, helping us. But our team is very local. And we have that experience in the lithium, but also in Argentina. And when you're building a project in a jurisdiction, you might as well have people from that jurisdiction because you need to speak the language, you need to understand how everything works in each of these jurisdictions. And that's extremely important. And that's one of our, in my mind, also an important part of who we are. We are definitely, we're listed in Toronto and we're listed in New York and so forth, or in the US, OTCQX, but we have a very localized management with a very specific knowledge in lithium and in local mining projects.
Absolutely. This interview is very well timed on the back of Tesla's Battery Day. What are your thoughts on what Elon was saying there about lithium?
Well, I'll start with this. I think that one of the main important things is that Tesla by itself has said yesterday that they will need around 2.5 million tons of lithium carbonate equivalent by 2030. To give you an idea how big this is, today, the total demand today worldwide is 300,000 tons. They're saying they're going to need 8 to 9 to almost 10 times that amount by themselves in 10 years. And that's an incredible amount. Nobody was expecting that type of amount. Granted, this is not only for electric vehicles, this is also for their energy storage systems that they're working on, but this is an unbelievable amount of lithium carbonate, which is good news for the industry. They've mentioned to us three main buckets. One is that they want to grow the range of their vehicles by roughly 50%. They also want to reduce their battery costs by around 50 to 60%. And they also want to reduce their capital investment per gigawatt hour by 70%. Even if you cut that in half, all those in half, that is an unbelievable achievement, I believe, for Tesla. They want to be the biggest and baddest car manufacturer and in the world, right? So they're ahead of many of the other well-established OEMs, and they keep demonstrating that they're willing to push a lot of their assumptions and a lot of their work towards a goal that, to become the very best, period. Look, did I believe everything they said, specifically on the lithium side? Not necessarily. I think they oversimplified certain things, specifically on the Nevada asset, that they think that they can get lithium for all their entire use in the U.S. I think that's an oversimplification. But, you know, we need a lot more assets in the market to be able to give Tesla and other car manufacturers the amount of lithium that they're asking for. I mean, 2.5 million tons of lithium carbonate just by Tesla, it's an incredible amount. There's not enough lithium today in the works to provide that. So positive news all around. The market didn't see it that way. Everybody was down anywhere between 5 and 20% today in the lithium space. But that's just, I believe, a very short-sighted way of looking at the market. I mean, if you look at the bigger picture, this is extremely good news for everybody.
Mm. And I mean, he was talking about sort of $25,000 EVs. And that makes them extremely affordable. And then you've got people like Volkswagen, bringing out new models all the time. If they become mass market, which they inevitably will, huge upside potential there.
Yeah, look, I mean, that's exactly, I've always said lithium electrical vehicles will never be mainstream until you have a car that everybody can buy. And a $25,000 car or $35,000 car is a car that most people are able to purchase. So a $100,000 car, not many people can buy that. And that's exactly what, you know, Tesla has been selling over the last few, maybe a little bit less, but at least Canadian dollar wise, that's about right. So, you know, it's been hard for a lot of people to buy an electric vehicle. But nowadays, if you're telling me they're going to have a $25,000 to $35,000 car, that brings it to the masses. And that's exactly what we want. We want that to start rolling forward. And everybody's saying the same thing, right? I mean, it's not only Tesla. You got all the other car manufacturers looking at ways to produce cars at a cheaper way and fast. So 21, it's going to be a year that I believe things are in the lithium space are going to turn around quite quickly and quite dramatically. You're going to see everybody scrambling to get a hand of a lot of lithium because batteries are going to be needed.
And so when is your project going to be sort of coming on stream?
Well, that's a good question. Now that we have CATL on board, one of the problems we're having right now is the COVID situation. And when I say that, everybody says this as a way of giving everybody more time. But in our case, Argentina essentially shut down. You can't go provinces through province to travel, and you can't travel from Canada to Argentina or from China to Argentina and vice versa. So we're going to have some delay, but if everything goes as planned, we're going to finish our feasibility roughly first half of next year. That doesn't mean we're not going to have a financing plan in place by that time. In fact, you know, we could potentially have one, and we could potentially be starting to build even before that. But that is not something that we can, you know, we can assure. So our plan is to finalize our feasibility by first half of next year, without further delays. But we don't know how this COVID situation is going to evolve over the next 3 to 6 to 9 months. Nobody really knows. But that's our hope, and that we're going to work towards that, and then have a complete financing plan by that time and start building next year. That is our purpose, and we'll be producing the year after. So, you know, that is what we're hoping to have for the market.
Fantastic. Well, you've got a busy couple of years ahead of you, I think. But that's been a very interesting look there at Neo Lithium and your thoughts on the lithium market. So thank you very much, Carlos, for joining us today.
Thank you for having us, Leo. Appreciate the time.